All right, class. The last two lectures of the course. These will also be the two most controversial lectures of the course. Not the ones we did on sex, not the ones we did on religion. These two. And the reason for that is because we're going to try to integrate what we've learned about genetic and cultural evolution to explain Western ascendancy. Talking about why Europe was able to dominate the rest of the world is an unfashionable and uncomfortable topic of conversation. But it's exactly because the West ended up dominating that it has become uncomfortable to talk about that. And so before we launch into this, it's probably a good time for us to revisit our is ought and ought is problems. So you'll remember, because I've tested you on it multiple times, that the is ought problem is when you allow a factual claim, an is claim, to determine a moral position, an ought claim. In this case, we should not be conflating that Western culture did ascend, that it did manage to dominate the world, that the ideas embedded within Western culture were culturally adaptive. That says nothing about whether it was a good outcome or whether those adaptive phenomena were actually good from a moral perspective. And so let's be clear about that at the beginning. We are not making moral claims in our attempt to explain factual ones. This conclusion is fallacious. But we also have to remember our ought is problem, where your moral position problematically determines your factual claim. We can't say that simply because we think that Western ascendancy was bad, that it didn't happen. That is also a problem. That is also erroneous. The West very much, at least from the perspective of history right now, did manage to triumph over the rest of the world. And there's perhaps no better illustration of that than the fact that I am a man of Indian descent, employed on Musqueam territory, speaking to you, a class that is largely made up of East Asians and Persians and Germans, and we're all talking in the language of a tiny island in the North Atlantic. Somehow, they got the whole world speaking the Queen's English. English is the most spoken language in the world, both in terms of numbers, total numbers of speakers, as well as the number of countries in which it's spoken. That is an excellent illustration of the cultural dominance of the ideas of just actually a sliver of the West. We can also look at it in economic terms. Here is a breakdown of the share of the world's gross domestic product split by various empires. Starting from 1 AD going all the way to 2008, the brink of the Great Recession. And what you can see is that at least for the last 200 years, the bulk of the economic output of the world was produced by a combination of countries that we would call Western countries, predominantly the United States, but also the European powers, and you can throw Russia in there as well. The rest of the world produced only a minority of that economic production. You can see at what we might call the peak of Western power, which was around the middle of the last century. You can say that the American Empire hit its peak right around the JFK era, before they started their long decline with their misadventures in Vietnam. Around then, you see that if you add up all the West, you're looking at 70 to 80% of the entire economic output of the world, and that's for maybe 15% of the world's population. It actually becomes more striking when you look at how much of the economic production was divided among a relatively small group of the world's population. The United States on its own controlled a third of the economic output of the world and had only 5% of the world's population. If you look at gross domestic product per capita around that peak, let's take 1962, the United States had a GDP per capita in those 1962 dollars of $3,000 a person. The UK was about half of that. They took a big blow in World War II. But look at the other major countries that existed in the world then. Egypt, Nigeria, China, India. A tiny, tiny fraction per person of economic production. So why? How did we get here? Now, the attempts to delineate this from a historical perspective usually fall into two camps. One camp is that of the long-term lock-in theories, and these suggest that there was something deep in the past that more or less inevitably would have led it to Western dominance, that this was sort of baked in from a long time ago. And the other are short-term accident theories, which suggest that some random occurrences, the wind blowing this way, some battle going that way, some person who happened to be in the right place at the right time, actually somewhat randomly led to this particular outcome. Now you can see that these theories are somewhat akin to something we talked about a long time ago in terms of convergent evolution. You remember the idea of Simon Conway Morris, who suggested that there was something inevitable about the outcome of a warm-blooded, big-brained, hands-free species on the planet. This was such a good evolutionary solution that eventually we would have gotten here, regardless of the asteroids that hit at the right time and the particular glacial periods and all the particular environmental pressures which led to certain things evolving rather than others. Well, this was sort of baked in at the beginning. Whereas the other idea is, well, no, if you ran the tape again, you'd have a completely different outcome because just random chances, a butterfly being squashed at this moment and some ectoplasm getting funneled into that pool rather than that pool led to a completely different history. So which of these is true? Well, let's first explore one explanation which has justifiably fallen out of favor. Up until this point in the course, we've been talking about the evolution of the human species as a unitary whole. At this point, we're now talking about the different civilizations, the East and the West, the Africans, the Australians, all these groups diverging. What has previously been one story of the incredible human journey now becomes many stories. To explain the diversity of paths that our species has subsequently taken, one explanation is what's called creationist polygenism. Poly meaning multiple, genism meaning origins. That the human races were created separately with different origins and with different destinies. For many points that have become clear throughout the course, this is not an explanation we're going to take seriously. One that has somewhat more scientific authority to it, or at least did, is evolutionary polygenism. Not that these races were created separately by some deity, but that they evolved separately. This was, unsurprisingly, the theory that was in vogue around the turn of the last century. And one path that explained how that could have happened is the multi-regional hypothesis of human origins. This was popularized by the zoologist Ernst Haeckel and the paleoanthropologist Eugene Dubois. And they suggested that humans originated evolutionarily in South and Southeast Asia, presuming that we shared common ancestors with the gibbons and the orangutans that lived in that area. We then split into the various different races that they categorized people into, and that the common ancestry between these different races was actually pretty far back in our evolutionary history. Now, we now know that this is wrong, and it was certainly influenced by racist ideologies of the time, but it wasn't a completely scientifically outlandish theory of the time based on the evidence that they then had. If you looked at the human ancestor fossils that had been discovered at the time, this does not seem like an unreasonable conclusion. Eugene Dubois, who I mentioned, was the first person to discover what we now know as a Homo erectus skull. He discovered it on the island of Java in Indonesia. This was at the outer reach of what we now think was the habitat that Homo erectus ultimately expanded to. You saw this map a long time ago, I think maybe in our first lecture. This was the likely ultimate range of Homo erectus. Homo erectus was the first of our ancestors to actually move out of Africa, and it went pretty far east from there. Eugene Dubois discovered in the late 1800s the fossil that was then called Java Man. Contrast that with another fossil that was discovered about 40 years later, which was then called Peking Man, called such because it was discovered in China. These were, we now know, both fossils of Homo erectus, but we also know that they were separated by potentially over a million years. So they were quite different, having seen substantial evolutionary differences between them. It's not surprising that they were perceived to be members of different species, which eventually evolved into the different races of the people who were in those locations then. Meanwhile, in Europe, you had Neanderthal fossils that people had been discovering since the mid-1800s, and that you didn't see anywhere else. And then in Africa, of course, you had the entire raft of what we now know to be our common ancestors, the Homo habilis, the Australopithecines, all of these groups. You had all those fossils found in Africa, but not elsewhere. So it wasn't an unreasonable thing to conclude that these were all the different origins of the different races of the human species. But we now know that this is wrong. We now know that the Homo erectus that had moved out of Africa, gone all the way east to China and Indonesia, and the Neanderthals that had moved up into Europe, other than some admixture, all of these people died off, and that the people who were our ancestors were in Africa that entire time. And so we can now redraw this multi-regional model to the one we now believe, which is the out-of-Africa hypothesis. And in that situation, humans didn't originate in South and Southeast Asia, descending from a common ancestor with the orangutan, but instead descended, as we know, from a common ancestor with the chimpanzee in Africa. And our hominid ancestors actually had several waves of migration out of Africa, the first being that ill-fated migration by the Homo erectus, which did produce Peking Man and Java Man, but then ended there. Those lines went extinct. Several hundred thousand years later, Homo heidelbergensis also ventured out of Africa, evolved into the Neanderthals, but also more or less went extinct. It was only a subsequent migration around 70,000 years ago that went out into Europe and East Asia and Australia, did some admixture with the remaining Neanderthals, and then evolved into the various races that we categorize now. And what that means is that our human story was until very recently a singular story. Here's a migration map, and it shows you something that we've talked about before already, which is that up until 70,000 years ago, we were all clustered on a single continent. In the intervening time, there have been evolutionary divergences. For instance, we have different skin color. We have different eyes and nose shapes, but those differences are superficial and unlikely to be sufficient to explain the different civilizational paths that we've taken. Now, the story is actually a little more complicated than I've laid it out here, and we do tend to discover things every year or so, which slightly tweaks the story here. But what it means is that we can consider ourselves not a polygenic species, but a monogenic species. The human race evolved as a single species. And these genetic differences that have occurred since that divergence 70,000 years ago are, as I mentioned, unlikely to be the answer to the question of why it was the West that ascended. So let's return to our question. How did we get here? How do we explain Western ascendancy? How do we explain the differences that we've seen between the Western countries around the middle of the last century and everywhere else? Divine favor and genetic differences are unlikely to be the explanations. So what does that leave? Well, there have been a number of books that have tried to tackle this, each trying to give one big explanation for these differences. These often cluster as geographic explanations, that the difference in the climate or the flora or fauna or other aspects of the particular environment in which these different civilizations were located was the cause of the difference. Other books focus on the culture, that there's something about the political institutions or the types of cultural ethos in the place which led to the differences. And still other historical books talk about accidents of history. These are the short-term accident theories. There were certain moments where history went one way rather than another, and that made all the difference. Guns, Germs, and Steel, which is, I think, the best-selling history book of all time, is probably the canonical big history book, which takes this geographic explanation for this. Another example of that is Ian Morris's excellent Why the West Rules for Now, which builds on Jared Diamond's Guns, Germs, and Steel. In the culture section, you have Neil Ferguson's Civilization book, the one he was talking about in the video that you guys watched for your readings this week, as well as Joe Henrich's new book, The Weirdest People in the World, How the West Became Psychologically Peculiar and Particularly Prosperous, which is a dense and long book to get through. I'm not yet through it. And then on the accidents of history side, well, David Landis's The Wealth and Poverty of Nation takes both a cultural and an accidents of history approach. And then there's a huge raft of other historical books which investigate certain battles and place a large amount of weight on certain moments in history. I don't think any of these gives the entire explanation. And in fact, I think that the different components of these explanations factor in at different timescales. And I'll show you what I mean here. Take a look at this chart here. This shows you the change in human population sizes from 50,000 years ago to the year 2000. And you see that thin green line? That's the number of hunter-gatherers that have been on the planet. And you see that it doesn't really change from 50,000 years ago to now. And that's because you can only sustain so large a population living in these nomadic hunter-gatherer tribes. But look at the blue line. You see that there are two points at which it jumps. The most recent one, where you see this real knee of the curve going up from 300 million people to 6 billion people, well, that's what happened after the Industrial Revolution just a few hundred years ago. But the first one, around 10,000 or 12,000 years ago, that was the product of the Agricultural Revolution. Civilization, as we know it, doesn't get started until the Agricultural Revolution. It's not until we stop being these nomadic hunter-gatherers and settle down into permanent settlements fed by agriculture that you see the accumulation of technology and culture in a way that produces something we can call civilization. It was only possible because of climactic changes that happened around 12,000, 14,000 years ago. The last ice age ended, warming the planet and flooding the atmosphere with more oxygen than it existed before, allowing for the cultivation of plants. That's what allowed for the agricultural revolution to be born. Now, Jared Diamond and Ian Morris both talk extensively about the geographic determinism that led into which civilizations were able to best benefit from the agricultural revolution and everything that happened since. Morris talks about these lucky latitudes. These were latitudes on the planet that were most blessed with plants and animals that you could benefit from in an agricultural revolution. Those populations that happened to land in these particular lucky latitudes were most able to jumpstart a civilization and have that head start going into the next 10,000 years. However, Jared Diamond's point is maybe even more important. Look at the orientation between the shape of the various continents. The Americas are oriented vertically. Africa is oriented vertically. That is, it's longer than it is wide. Eurasia, however, is wider than it is long. Why would that matter? Just because of how the Earth's axis is oriented, there's more change in the climactic environment when you move vertically on the planet between, say, north and south, than if you move horizontally from east to west. And you can intuit this well. So Vancouver and, say, London are on similar latitudes, and Vancouver and, say, Mexico City are on similar longitudes. Which is more likely to have a more similar environment to Vancouver? The one that's on the same horizontal plane or the one that's on the same vertical plane? Clearly, Vancouver is more similar to London in terms of its a climate than it is to Mexico City. And that's because of this idea of climactic change happening less east to west than it does north to south. Now, why does that matter? Well, it means that the environment and the solutions to that environment are going to be very similar across an east to west continent than a north to south one, which means that innovations made in one place can spread and be useful on a vast area east to west in a way that they wouldn't be north to south. You can have the free spread of useful ideas and trade to a much greater degree on a horizontally oriented continent than on a vertical one. Now, what that means is that the Eurasian continent had an advantage from the beginning in a long-term locked-in manner. It had a baked-in advantage in that culture could spread more easily and more usefully between different parts of the continent than in the Americas or Africa. Those other continents were at a disadvantage. You couple that with these lucky latitudes ideas, and what it suggests is that just from a geographical standpoint, the populations that existed on the Eurasian continent in those lucky latitudes had an enormous advantage in terms of their civilizational abilities. This is a chart from Guns, Germs, and Steel. And what it shows is how certain geographic advantages early on, many suitable wild species, that's wild species of both plants and animals that were able to be put to use, and the ease of species spreading, those are advantages that existed in Europe. Those led to the ability to have many domesticated plant and animal species, enabling the agricultural revolution, as well as the use of animals as beasts of burden. That allowed for greater food surpluses and food storages, allowed for larger, denser populations. We talked before about how larger, denser, more integrated populations are able to produce more culture, and that allowed for a proliferation of technology, which gave those Eurasian civilizations a distinct advantage against all others. And so from the beginning, it was almost baked in that the civilizations that emerged in Africa and on the Americas were not going to be the ones that were going to dominate the planet, at least not at first. So that gives us an example about how these long-term locked-in theories, and in particular this category of geographic determinism, narrows down which civilizations were going to be the ones who were going to triumph. But it doesn't explain it all. Eurasia's a big place. There are a lot of civilizations on it, not just the West. In the next lecture, we're going to talk about the three big ones. The West, which we're going to define as the civilization which descended from the Fertile Crescent, the Egyptian civilizations growing to the Roman Empire. This is where you see the Roman Empire, and then reaching its peak around the middle of the 20th century. In addition to the West, the other two big civilizations of the Eurasian continent were the Muslim Empire, which grew enormously and rapidly with the conquests of Muhammad in the 7th century, and then spread to a pretty large section of the globe at its peak. And then China. So here you have China during the Han Dynasty, a golden age in its era, and then during the Ming Dynasty, when it reached at least another peak in its civilizational power. These three civilizations were all at one time the most powerful civilizations on the planet. This is not surprising from a geographical standpoint, but as I mentioned, it leaves open the question as to why it was the West, why it was the European civilizations that were the ones that ultimately dominated the planet during our lifetimes. That's the question that we're going to be able to finally answer in the epic conclusion in the next lecture.